World leaders attending the APEC summit in San Francisco pose for a family photo. Among them, U.S. President Joe Biden and his Chinese counterpart Xi Jinping, who held a high-stakes summit Wednesday. APEC members have been closely watching developments between the world's two largest economies and strategic rivals amid concerns more intense competition could upset global trade and security. The 21-member APEC accounts for about 62% of global GDP and almost half of global trade. Tensions in the West Philippine Sea high on the agenda as President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. meets with Chinese leader Xi Jinping. In a video message, Marcos said he will meet with Xi on the sidelines of the APEC summit to discuss ways to de-escalate maritime tensions. He insists the Philippines is committed to maintain peace in the region despite China's continuing aggressive behavior.
Together the ways forward, because we are continuously trying to maintain the peace. And now that's what I see the mission of the Philippines, the Philippine Coast Guard, the Philippine military, our fishermen, all of us. It's our basic fundamental mission here is to maintain the peace. And that is essentially what we discussed. And again, we will get the view of the Chinese president on what we can do to bring down the temperature, to not escalate the situation in the West Philippine Sea. And we will put all of these together so as we'll be able to strategize for the near future on what the Philippines' role will be, or what is the proper Philippines' role in the West Philippine Sea.
The president's upcoming talks with Xi follows a meeting with U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris. Marcos says during that meeting, the U.S. and the Philippines reiterated their shared commitment to upholding international rules and norms. U.S. Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin also reaffirming Washington's ironclad commitment to the Philippines. Austin met with his Philippine counterpart, Gilbert Teodoro Jr., on the sidelines of the ASEAN Defense Ministers Meeting Plus in Jakarta. A joint statement by the two officials denounced China's harassment of the Philippine vessel and a U.S. aircraft in the South China Sea. The defense chiefs emphasized the 2016 arbitral tribunal ruling that swept aside China's expansive maritime claims. They called on China to abide by its obligations under international law. The Philippines has called for the removal of what it says are China's illegal structures in the West Philippine Sea. It pressed China to take full accountability for the damage it caused within the country's maritime borders. The Philippine Foreign Affairs Department also defended the legitimacy of the country's resupply missions to its Navy outposts in the Ayungin Shoal. It insists Beijing does not have to be given prior notification since the resupply missions are done within the exclusive economic zone of the Philippines. Beijing had accused Manila last week of illegally entering Chinese waters and justified the dangerous maneuvers of its Coast Guard vessels near Philippine resupply ships. President Marcos is set to bring home investment opportunities from the U.S. Marcos inked a $400 million deal with American firms aimed at providing internet satellites to remote areas in the Philippines. The $20 million U.S. FDA facility also set to be built in the country. Marcos says there is a need to ensure no one is left behind in the pursuit of APEC's economic goals.
We can only be as strong as the weakest members of our economies, of our societies. Regardless of how much progress we make in these halls, if such does not translate to a better quality of life, about resiliency for all, we will remain derailed by even the most subtle of shocks and insecurities that are beyond our control.
Congressional leaders deny rumors of an impeachment plot against Vice President Sara Duterte. RG Cruz reports.
Two House officials maintain that the House of Representatives is not out to destroy Vice President Sara Duterte or her family. House Deputy Majority Leader for Communications, ACCIS Representative Erwin Tufo, maintained that the House leadership is not plotting the Vice President's impeachment over her use of confidential funds in 2022.
Eh, hindi, parang it's not enough, parang hindi, it will not hold water. Hindi siya ganong kalakas na pwede. Siguro baka kung may mga in the future other facts, details, then natin, that will be different, di ba? Pero for now kasi, wala eh. Kung ano-anong impeachment because of CIF, will that be enough substance? I don't know. It will still have to be reviewed. Pero like what the leadership is saying, there's none. Walang pag-uusap, walang plano pagbalik namin sa Lunes, pagdating ni Speaker, no such thing, no impeachment right now versus the Vice President.
Before this, House Deputy Minority Leader Franz Castro claimed congressmen have been talking about the impeachment, though nothing is serious. She even called such talks a sign that the rift in the so-called unity team of the Vice President with the President is growing. Tufo disputed Castro's statements.
I don't know where Kong Castro got it. Kaya medyo nagulat din yung leadership kanina kung saan nang galing yon. And I found out nga, nagsabi sa akin ng media na galing kay Kong Castro. Alam naman natin yung mga grounds ng impeachment. At this point, wala eh. Wala tayong nakikita na she violated the Constitution. So bakit i-impeach yung tao?
For Tulfo, it's nothing but malicious gossip, but maintains they will have to scrutinize any future complaints.
Intriga. That's what I can say. And that's what everybody, the leadership will say, intriga. There's something the House is going after the Duterte family. There's no such thing, ma'am, as unity against the Vice President, unity behind Speaker Romualdez, or marching order from the Speaker. Unite para sa taong bayan and move forward. Hindi yung unite behind the speaker, unite versus Sara Duterte and her family. There's no such thing.
In his own statement, House Majority Leader Manuel Jose Dalipe called the supposed plot to impeach the Vice President fake news, baseless and detrimental to political unity. In an interview on a TV program hosted by Pastor Apollo Quiboloy Wednesday night, the Vice President's father, former President Rodrigo Duterte, sees and a potential face-off between Sara and the Speaker in the 2028 presidential elections.
Itong si Romualdez is posturing to be a candidate for president. Ngayon, akala niya, ang kalaban niya si Inday. Because si Inday yung vice president, naturally, she might want to go for the presidency. Ito namang Romualdez, kasi sila yung power, kapinsan niya si Marcos, they want to consolidate. So, kinuha niya lahat, pati lahat congressman. Lahat ng mga PDP.
Laban.
Wala nang naiwan.
But Dalipe denies Speaker Romualdez is plotting to take out the Vice President as a potential rival in 2028. Dalipe said no decision has been made about the Speaker's 2028 plans and that he has always respected the Vice President. Dalipe likewise explained that any impeachment complaint will go through a rigorous process before it is even considered by Congress. Dalipe tells the Vice President's supporters there's no basis for concern over the rumors so long as she's done nothing wrong, and he urged the public to refrain from spreading rumors. Last week, the House approved a resolution in defense of the chamber and Representative Martin Romualdez's speakership after former President Rodrigo Duterte lashed out at the House for taking away the Vice President's confidential funds. The House also took away the deputy speakerships of two known Duterte allies. At the same time, former President Duterte's party mates have started moving to other parties. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
The word war between former President Rodrigo Duterte and House Minority Leader Franz Castro continues. Castro says Duterte is making fun of her grave threat complaint, calling it a blatant disrespect of the Philippine justice system. This after Duterte said he will just go to jail when asked about his response to the complaint. He also accused Castro of yet again of being a Communist Party member. Meanwhile, Attorney Harry Roque is set to represent Duterte in the case, but it is not yet clear if the former president will personally attend the probe. Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Remulla slams a UN official for recommending the abolition of the country's anti-communist task force. See, United Nations expert Ian Fry condemned the agency for red-tagging communities, saying it is already operating beyond its original mandate. But for Remulla, the UN rapporteur also should not tell the Philippine government what to do. He adds Fry should not interfere in the matter since it is an internal mechanism of the Philippine government. The Philippine Central Bank leaves interest rates unchanged as expected. The BSP retained its benchmark rate at 6.5% during Thursday's meeting of its monetary board. This decision follows its off-cycle rate hike of 25 basis points in late October. It cites moderating inflation expectations and tighter financial conditions for keeping rates steady. This as it's lowered its forecast for the Consumer Price Index until 2025, projecting it to be the near 2 to 4% target range by next year. But it notes inflation risks remain tilted to the upside.
The Monetary Board noted that keeping the policy rate steady will allow previous policy interest rate adjustments, including the interest rate increase in October, to continue to work their way through the economy. Looking ahead, the Monetary Board continues to deem it necessary to keep monetary policy settings sufficiently tight until a sustained downtrend in inflation becomes fully evident and inflation expectations are firmly anchored. Key upside risks are associated with the potential impact of higher transport charges, electricity rates, and international oil prices, as well as of higher than expected minimum wage adjustments in areas outside the National Capital Region.
But for economist Eubin Paracueles, the BSP is done with its rate hiking cycle. He also sees rate cuts by September next year.
Where they will be hawkish is on the language. As we saw, the BSP needs to signal that they stand ready to resume hiking, because obviously if they pivot too early, and this is what the governor Eli is saying, that if you do that too early, I think the risk is inflation risk start to pick up again and inflation expectations start to be affected negatively. So you don't want, as a central banker, you don't want that to happen because the job gets harder, right? So I think they'll be a bit more cautious when it comes to the pivot. And so again, it will be all about inflation and when it returns to the 2 to 4% target. Once it goes below 4% and BSP feels a bit more comfortable that it stays there and it's more well-entrenched, then I think they can start cutting. So for me, that's in September 2024. And again, it will be a sort of a gradual cutting cycle to ensure that inflation stays within the target range.